Well, hi guys. It's another beautiful day to explore God's Word. Would you get your Bibles out and get ready as we take off into the Jump Ministry message of the day. Let's go. Well, hi guys. We're going to have our indescribable devotion today. Hi, Corey.
Hi. Hi, Penny Pig. Hi.
Oh, Penny Pig. We're going to have our indescribable devotion, and then we'll have our Bible message. Today, our devotion is called What God Sees. We've been talking about what new spiritual rebirth means and what being a new creation in Christ means. Well, today, our topic is What God Sees. Did you know that on a clear night, away from city lights and using only your eyes, you can see all the way to the Andromeda Galaxy, which is located an astonishing 2.5 million light years from Earth? And on a really good night, you can see all the way to a star named Deneb, one of the brightest stars in our Milky Way galaxy. Scientists aren't sure exactly how far away Deneb is, but they think it's at least 9 quadrillion miles away, or a 9 followed by a whole bunch of zeros. We may have talked about this before, but I like this devotion so much, I wanted to bring it back up to you. Now, look here. God made your eyes amazingly powerful, so you can see just a bit of His magnificent creation. Look how big your eyes are. Yeah. But as powerful as your eyes are, God's eyes are even more powerful. He can see the farthest star in the farthest galaxy of the universe. He can also see the shortest hair on the left leg of the tiniest bug. And He can see every hair on your head and count every single one. Did you know the Bible says that? Yeah, I don't have too much hair anymore, do I? But in Luke chapter 12, verse 7, it says God knows every hair on our heads. God can see absolutely everything. And He sees you perfectly and completely. But when God looks at you, He doesn't just look at the outside. Your clothes, your hair, or your nose. God looks much deeper than that. He looks at your heart. He sees all the things that are filling your heart. He sees the worries. He sees the doubts. He sees what makes you happy and what scares you. He sees the anger, the jealousy, and all those secret sins that you think no one else knows about. God already knows everything in your heart, so you can tell Him anything at all. When you talk to Him, He promises to fill your heart with peace. Ask God to help your heart look more like His, filled with wonderful things like love and joy and kindness. God, thank You for giving me eyes to see the wonder and beauty of Your creation all around me. Help me see how I can be more like You today. And here's an amazing fact. Your eyes blink about 12 times every minute. That's more than 10,000 blinks every day, not counting when you're asleep, of course. Did you know that you close your eyes and you blink when you're sleeping? Yeah, you don't even blink, do you? Okay. Your eyes blink. Look, each blink lasts about 0.3 seconds, which means you have your eyes closed for more than 50 minutes every day. I got to think about that. Our eyes are closed more than 50 minutes every day. Okay, well, we're going to have to think about that one. But the point was that God sees everything. He doesn't just look on the outside. Hey! He doesn't just look on the outside and see these cool little Carhartt, whatever they are. What's this thing called? Now I'm losing it. Overalls. He doesn't just look at your cool hat and your cool hair and your cool nose and Penny Pig. He looks inside us. He looks inside. He wants to see us growing inside to be more like who?
Jesus.
That's right, Jesus. So today, we're going to learn about a story. Or we're going to learn a story about. That's a better way of putting it. Remember I told you that when you come to Christ, you become a new creation? Well, the man that wrote those words in 2 Corinthians chapter, what was it, 5 verse 7? I think it was, or was it 15 verse 7? I don't remember now. We'll find it. He actually changed big time when he met Jesus. So today, I'm going to introduce you to the writer of those words. I'm going to tell you how he used to be. And then maybe tomorrow's Thursday, I'll tell you what happened to him And then we'll summarize Friday. Maybe that's what I'll do. Or I'll just tell you the whole story today. Be right back. Say bye.
Bye.
See ya. Okay. I got tired of looking down at the computer, so I just moved the camera up a little bit. That way I can see you better. All right. I found the verse I was talking to you about. I don't know why I forgot this. It's 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 17. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old has passed away, and see, the new has come. What a beautiful thing. Everything is from God who has reconciled, that means brings us back together. Everything in verse 18 is from God who has reconciled us to himself through Christ and has given us the ministry of reconciliation. That is, in Christ, God was reconciling the world to himself, not counting their trespasses against them, and he has committed the message of reconciliation to us. What this means is, before we came to Christ and before we became new creations, we were sinning and we were away from God. It means that we weren't as close to God as we should be. Our fellowship was hurt. Our friendship was hurt. The only way to restore that was to get rid of our sin. And we couldn't do that ourselves. So God said, well, then there's only one thing to do. I'm going to send my son. And he's going to take all the sins of the world like they're his own. And then he's going to be punished terribly by being placed onto a cross and killed. But he's going to come back to life. The Holy Spirit of God is going to bring him back from death. And he's going to walk again and he's going to be fully alive again. And that's exactly what happened with Jesus. And that's exactly what happened with us. We will die someday and our bodies will be buried. And then if we have followed Christ and we believe he's our Savior, we will be raised from the dead also. Isn't that amazing? Because as soon as we die, we go to heaven. Oh, this is just amazing stuff. Amazing. And so the man that wrote this was talking about reconciling, bringing us back to God through Jesus Christ. And he says, when all that's happening, you're a new person. You're a new creation. Well, the guy that wrote this wasn't a real good guy early on when he started out. And so our story today is about what I'm talking about, how he started to become a new person, a new creation, a new creature in Christ. Come with me to the book of Acts that's in the New Testament. I believe it's the 5th book. Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, Acts. Come there. And in the 7th chapter, we read about a young man named Stephen. And Stephen loved Jesus. And so he was given a talk, a sermon, a message. He was talking one day to a large group of people. And he began telling them all about God. And he went way back in history. And he started teaching them things that had happened way before they were all born. But they all knew what he was saying. And they all knew what he was saying was true. And so, very slowly, he took them on a history lesson. And he was teaching them things and reminding them things. Well, as he began to really preach, and now he got up in history towards the time of Jesus, and Jesus had already been crucified. He'd already been dead, buried, resurrected, and gone back home to glory. And so Stephen is going to remind all the people what they did to Jesus. And some of the people in the crowd did not like this message. And they got so mad at Stephen, they began throwing rocks at him. They drug him out. Listen to this. I'll read this to you. Because this is in the book of Acts. And my book wasn't changed. I need to change it. Here we go. Listen to this. After Stephen told them about Jesus and how he's in heaven now and everything's fine, but they needed to repent of what they did. And they got really mad at him. They yelled. I'm in verse 57 of chapter 7. They yelled at the top of their voices, covered their ears because they didn't want to hear any more of this. And together rushed against him. That means like they all just ran towards him real quick. Oh man, they dragged him out of the city and began to stone him. This means they were throwing rocks at him. Why? Just for telling them about Jesus? They didn't want to hear what they had done. They didn't believe in Jesus. They didn't want to hear any more about him. He's dead. He's gone. They don't want to hear any more about him. Well, listen to this. And the witnesses laid their garments at the feet of a young man named Saul. They got so hot throwing rocks at Stephen that they would take their coats off. All right. And they were all standing around watching. And some of the guys that took their coats off gave them and laid them down on the ground in front of somebody to guard them so nobody would steal their coats. And guess who that young man was that they put the garments down at his feet? His name was Saul. Ooh, Saul. See if we hear some more about him. While they were stoning Stephen, he called out, "Lord Jesus, receive my spirit." He knelt down and cried out with a loud voice, "Lord, do not hold this sin against them." And after saying this, he died. He had been hit with so many rocks that his poor body was all broken up, and he died. What a terrible thing for someone to get killed just before talking about Jesus. Saul, I'm in verse 8, chapter 8, verse 1. Saul agreed with putting him to death. That means Saul went right along with it. Watching a man get brutally stoned to death, and Saul standing there going, yep, I agree with that. On that day, a severe persecution broke out against the church in Jerusalem, and all except the apostles were scattered throughout the land of Judea and Samaria. Devout men buried Stephen and mourned deeply over him. This means people that were true servants of the Lord. That's what devout is. That's like our deacons and our pastor. They're devout. It means they're committed to their jobs and their callings. They came and they picked Stephen's poor body up and they buried him because they loved him, and it was a sign of respect. Listen here. Saul, however, was ravaging the church. This means he was doing anything he could to break down the church and make people stop going to church. Oh, man. Saul, however, was ravaging the church. He would enter house after house, drag off men and women, and put them in prison. Putting people in prison for believing in Jesus. And that still goes on today all around the world. Isn't this crazy? And who's doing it? Saul. And so it talks about how the church just had to move. People had to move and go into different areas all around Jerusalem because they had to get out of there because they were in danger. And this was actually part of God's plan to spread the church and make the church go into new places. But Saul didn't know this. Do you want to hear the rest of the story about Saul? Or do you want to hear just how bad he was? Let's see if I can find some more stuff. I think what I'll do today is tell you what happened to him. Because he was being so, so nasty. Come to chapter 9. Chapter 9. Now Saul was still breathing threats and murder against the disciples of the Lord. He went to the high priest and requested letters from him to the synagogues in Damascus, so that if he found any men or women who belonged to the way, he might bring them as prisoners to Jerusalem. What Saul did, Saul hated the church and hated Jesus Christ so much that he went to those religious leaders that didn't like Jesus either, and he said, "Hey man, give me like a hall pass. So anywhere I go, I just got to show this pass and they'll let me come through." And what he was doing was he was getting permission to go hunt people down and bring them back to Jerusalem and throw them in jail or worse. And they did it and they gave him his letters. He got what he wanted. Look at this. As he traveled and was nearing Damascus, a light from heaven suddenly flashed around him. It might have been like a lightning bolt. We don't know. Falling to the ground, I guess he was on a horse or something. Falling to the ground, he heard a voice saying to him, "Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me?" "Who are you, Lord?" Saul said. "I am Jesus, the one you are persecuting," he replied. "But get up and go into the city and you'll be told what you must do." Well, evidently Saul wasn't by himself, because verse 7 says, "The men who were traveling with him stood speechless, hearing the sound, but seeing no one. Saul got up from the ground, and though his eyes were open, he could see nothing. So they took him by the hand and led him into Damascus. He was unable to see for 3 days, and he did not eat or drink." Now, I wonder about this. First of all, why did God let Saul do such mean things? Why? We're going to find out, and I'll tell you tomorrow a little more about Saul, because he was not a dummy. Saul was a real smart guy. Remember I told you about Nicodemus? All right, and knowing all the rules and knowing all the old scrolls and the old prophets and everything? So did Saul. Saul was also a Pharisee, and he knew all kinds of stuff about God, or so he thought. He didn't know anything about Jesus yet. And who does he meet on the road? Jesus. Can you imagine being on a horse and you're just riding down the road, you got your letters in your pocket, and you're looking forward to going to drag some people out and throw them in jail, you know, and all of a sudden, boom, 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 you know, lightning or whatever falls around, and you fall down, and you get up, and you're talking, and your eyes are open, and you're doing this, and you're, I can't see anything, and you hear a voice, and the voice says, I'm Jesus, and you're persecuting me. I'd have been terrified. And it says for 3 days he couldn't eat or drink. So his buddies in his traveling party had to guide him by the hand. He was helpless. And we're going to see what happens to him next. I think those 3 days he couldn't eat or drink were 3 days he was crying. I think he realized, uh-oh, maybe all that about that guy named Jesus was real. We'll talk about that some more tomorrow. About being a new creature. This was the beginning of Saul turning into someone else. That's for tomorrow. I love you. See you later. Let's close out in prayer and see where the Lord leads us. It looks like it's getting ready to pour. I'm sitting out in my driveway and I'm going to have to close all my windows in my car. So let me pray quick. Okay. All right, Lord, thank you for the rain. Thank you for getting me home safely today from the railroad. And I pray for my friends who are watching this. Just be with them and their families, Lord. I pray that they are healthy. I pray for our friends and loved ones in the hospital and for all the doctors and nurses and for all the specialty teams that are helping our friends. Oh, please, Lord, bring them home when they can come home. Lord, help us think about what it really means to be a new creation in Christ. And we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. I love you. I will see you, or at least I'll see you through the camera soon. God bless you. Bye-bye. Well, that's going to do it for now. Thank you for being with us today. I hope you enjoyed the message. Hey, if you want to ask me questions, you can always email me at jumpministry@mac.com. And my phone number is in the church directory. I'll be glad to discuss this with you, or perhaps you didn't understand something, and I can try to help clear it up. So have a great day. Until we get together again, God bless you and your families. Take care now. Bye-bye.